up, motherfuckers? Let me turn off my heater real fast, because it's getting hot up in this bitch before I start talking about this. Oh, it looks like I already turned that sumbitch off and forgot about it. Alright, motherfuckers, welcome. Welcome to all the new subscribers. I realize that I haven't done subscriber shoutouts in a while. I'm going to get to that, I think. But I think after that, we're going to do it. So if you want a shout-out and you're a new sub, you're going to have to write in the comments, because it's hard for me to keep track, because, you know, we're growing every day up in this, you know? Now, before we start, I just want to say one more thing, and that's this. I was working all day today, and I actually forgot to watch AEW. I forgot that wrestling was on today, you know? Part of that is because I was busy, but I'd be lying if I said that part of that isn't the fact that there's nothing to look forward to anymore. I mean, AEW has been horrible for the last few weeks. I mean, it's not really that good anyways, but sometimes it's bearable. Last few weeks has been completely horrible, and this week was absolutely no different. You know what I'm saying? So now let's start talking about the show. All right. First of all, the show starts off in the most annoying way imaginable. All right, we have Cucky Rhodes coming out there and cutting, like, a promo about himself, basically, right? Saying, like, talking about all the people in the TNT tournament and explaining how he should win, basically, right? It's just like, dude, enough of this self-absorbed, like, behavior. You know, we get it. This company is only there to boost Cody Rhodes' ego. I mean, this guy is a complete mark. He really starts to believe the things that he's, like, letting us think, you know? You'd think that this guy is, like, the best wrestler of all time, the way he talks about himself, the amount of exposure he gives himself, you know? Nobody cares about this guy. He sucks. And I'm not gonna lie, I was getting actually angry at this promo just because of the self-absorbed nature of this ass, you know what I mean? Unbelievable. Intolerable, honestly. Come on. You know? He also says that AEW critics will move the goalposts once again, implying that AEW has been proving us wrong, us being the critics, from day one or something. You know what I mean? Like, I've been saying the same shit about AEW for 6 months now, and that is that it's not that good, and there's an overexposure of Cody Rhodes, the Young Cucks, and to a degree, Cucky Omega. You know what I mean? Like, there's nothing, like, to watch here. There's nothing interesting going on, and Cody Rhodes operates under this premise that, you know, there's all these AEW haters that hate AEW for no reason, and AEW continues to prove the haters wrong, but, like, the haters keep changing the game, you know? They keep moving the goalposts. It's not what's happening at all. I speak for myself, and I think a lot of other people. I have no issue against AEW personally, obviously. That's fucking weird. I want them to do well. I want every wrestling company to do well. It's just that they're not doing well. It's as simple as that, motherfuckers. You know? So, that's all there is to it. Like, I mean, AEW, all they get is support. Everyone is like, oh, AEW. They get such overrated support and an overrated status that they actually start believing that they're better than they actually are. Which is not true, motherfuckers, you know what I'm saying? So next up, we had, what's his name? Tony Schiavone and Jericho talk about what we're going to see today. And every segment seems to be, we're going to hear from someone. We're going to hear from Matt Hardy. We're going to hear from Luke Harper. We're going to hear from MJF. I don't want to hear from these guys, man. They're not going to say anything interesting. So what the fuck do I want to hear from them for, you know? And then, like, it got me thinking for a second, because as soon as they showed Matt Hardy, I'm like, yo, every time a face comes to AEW or a face starts getting momentum, the inner circle wants that face. You know, the logic is that they don't want the face to beat Jericho for the title when Jericho had the title. But it's like, why don't they have the same attitude towards the heels? You know what I mean? Why hasn't, like, an inner circle approached some of the successful heels in the company? You know, namely, like, I mean, I don't want to say Wardlow, but Wardlow comes to mind. You know what I mean? Luke Harper, I get it. He's already in the stable, you know? But there's other heels in the company that inner circle should be like, oh, we need, like Neville, you know what I'm saying? Pac, right? They should just go to him and be like, hey, man, why don't you join us instead of making the death triangle? You know? Why do they always want their faces to join and turn heel? It's fucking weird, you know? It makes no sense. But anyways, that's what happened up until that point, motherfuckers. Next up, we had Darby Allin versus Sammy Guevara. Now, this match was retarded, and I'll explain why. There's pretty much one reason why. Sammy Guevara does a 630 and hits it on Darby Allin. Darby Allin kicks out. Now, for anyone out there that gets mad when Brock Lesnar kicks out of finishers, go fuck yourselves. Because we have a 110-pound jobber named Darby Allin, who I like, by the way, but a jobber nonetheless, kicking out of a 630. I mean, what the hell is this? You know, like, it's okay for Darby Allin to kick out of a 630, but Brock Lesnar can't kick out of a claymore or two? Get the fuck out of here. It's complete nonsense. You know what I mean? It's stupid. Darby Allin wins with the Last Supper, which is basically like a pin. And it's like a It's like a weird, it's like a figure four into a pin where he cradles the guy backwards or something, you know? I mean, like, it's not a horrible move. Stupid, you know? Like, it's just, he wrestles like Riho. You know, he wins with roll-ups. Who gives a fuck, you know? So he wins. No one cared. Next up, we have Cucky Omega versus Sami Zayn. I thought it was Sami Zayn when this guy came out. Then he took off his hat and he was bald. Now, this guy was about 5'1", about 125 pounds max, right? And Kenny Omega is supposed to be the best wrestler in the world, and he has like a long 20-minute match with this jobber, you know? And the jobber kicks out of the V-trigger once. You know what I mean? Like, this jobber, like, you'd think that this guy is like the next big thing. He's fighting the person that you've been telling me is the best wrestler in the world, and the best wrestler in the world needs 20 minutes to beat him. You know what I mean? This is a guy that Eric Rowan would beat in about 20 seconds. You know, Eric Rowan would, like, throw this guy outside. He'd look inside the cage. He'd come back in. Eric Rowan would hit the claw. That'd be it. You know, so I can't be sold on Kenny Omega being one of the best wrestlers in the world if he has 20-minute matches with everybody. You know what I mean? Like, he's not that small. Like, I remember when Rey Mysterio was champion, he did that kind of stuff. Like, he would have, like, competitive matches with even jobbers, you know, with, like, Shannon Moore and, like, Gregory Helms and people, like, that were obviously below him on the card. But, like, at the very least, Gregory Helms was, like, a great wrestler, number one. And two, Rey Mysterio is, like, 5'0". You know what I mean? Like, Rey Mysterio is even smaller than the guy that Kenny Omega beat. So it doesn't make any sense, man. You know, it's just bad writing. You know what I mean? So that's what happened. Next up, we have Orange Cassidy versus Jimmy Havoc. I mean, I'm going to be honest. I skipped most of this match. I knew what was going to happen. Orange Cassidy won with, like, what I call the Spike Dudley pin, which is kind of like a crucifix, except you hook the guy's leg too, you know? It was whatever. There was a spot in the match where Penelope Ford climbed to the apron, and she was distracted by Chucky T. And what's it called? Kip Sabian did like a Tope Suicida, or not a Tope Suicida, Tope Con Hilo on the Best Friends. But despite this, Orange Cassidy wins, you know? Which was like the inverse of what happened when I think it was Chuck Taylor lost to Kip Sabian, you know? Like, Jimmy Havoc interfered and he lost. In this case, the people interfere and the good guy wins. You know what I mean? Like, they interfere, the bad guy takes out the good guy, the good guys, I should say, the good best friends, and then the good guy, Orange Cassidy, wins anyways. You know, what was the point of that? What was the point of Kip Sabian taking these people out? You know, it doesn't make any sense. None of this makes any sense, motherfuckers, you know? Next up, we had probably the best segment of the night, in my opinion. You know, we had Wardlow versus a jobber. Now, I enjoy this a lot because I like Wardlow. I'm going to be honest. This guy's cool, man. He's a big dude. He's got a look. You know, he's got an awesome move, the F10, which is like a standing, spinning, throwing F5. You know, I like this guy. Also, we heard from MJF. He didn't say anything of value. We heard from Matt Hardy. And it was the first time that I've heard from Matt Hardy where I finally realized that the broken character, the broken gimmick is done, man. At this point, it's just a parody of itself. It's just him talking in the same tone, saying the same shit he's been saying for years now, motherfuckers. And the fact that he's like, the new essence in my vessel is Zenith, not whatever, Damascus, right? It's the same fucking shit, you know? Like, the implications are that now that there's a new essence in his vessel, it's somehow a new character, but it's not. Then all of a sudden, he transforms into normal Matt Hardy, who gives off this sanctimonious speech about how Jericho wants to knock down the pillars of AEW, the pillars of AEW being the Elite. And I'm just like, dude, what the fuck? Stop making everything about the Elite. Everything is about these assholes. I don't understand. You know, like, Jericho is not even feuding with him anymore. He's feuding with Matt Hardy now. You know, and kind of, the like, Inner Circle is feuding with Dean Ambrose. The Elite is not even around. You know, but all of a sudden, there's still, like, you know, there's still, like, the thing that people talk about. It pisses me off. They're not good. You know? So there you have it. What else? We saw a thing of Luke Harper giving a mask to a new guy. They didn't show the new guy's face. Now, he said he was 6'2 and 240 and played college football. I'm thinking it's Tino Sabatelli from NXT, except for that non-compete clause, motherfuckers. Unless maybe it is him, and, like, you know, they're just introducing him later, and this is just some jobber that's playing the role right now. But that's the kind of wrestler that he seemed to be, like a nice mid-level size, like, athletic type. I'm thinking to myself, dude, why are you hiding this guy's face? Like, it better be someone relevant. I mean, if it's just like, you know, Jim Matthews, the new wrestler, like, why is his face hidden? Like, who gives a fuck? You know, just be like, this is Jim Matthews, the end. So there you go. Plus, why are all these wrestlers so, like, sad with their lives? They have to join the Dark Order. You know, it doesn't make any sense. And furthermore, I mean, like, I get it. Coronavirus is all over the place. So Luke Harper can't, like, you know, Luke Harper and the Dark Order can't be there to kind of promote themselves. But let's be real. All of that aside, the reality is what the reality is. Luke Harper joined the Dark Order. He's supposed to be the Exalted One, but he doesn't feel like the Exalted One. You know what I mean? He doesn't feel like a leader. He just feels like another guy joined the Dark Order, you know? And I couldn't help thinking to myself, why not just do the same exact thing they're doing with Luke Harper, but with Evil Uno, you know? I mean, the answer is obviously clear. Evil Uno is obese. But, like, you understand what I'm saying? Like, he doesn't add anything. It's not like Luke Harper is this guy who's, like, known for his charisma or known for his promo skills or known for his leadership or really known for anything, you know? There's absolutely no point in this. He's just there. He's just another guy in the Dark Order, you know? All they've done is replace Evil Uno, who was clearly the leader. He would sit on the human throne. They've replaced him with Brody Lee. I mean, like, nothing's changed, you know? And it got me thinking, like, why not change it around? I mean, it's too late now, but, like, when they first started thinking of this, right? Just make Wardlow the Exalted One. I know it'd be kind of weird to be kind of left field. And put Brody Lee with MJF, you know? It makes much more sense. Like, someone that needs a push. Like, what the fuck is Luke Harper going to do, really? I mean, thus far, it's been a complete flop, in my opinion. So there you go. You know, I don't really see anything coming from this. Couldn't give a fuck. Next up, I already talked about Wardlow up in this bitch. We had Luke Harper beating a jobber. The amount of jobbers that they had in this show was unbelievable. I understand that, like, coronavirus, once again, is pissing in our collective soup. But let's be real. On ringside, they had, like, Billy Gunn and his son. Why not do a tag match? Billy Gunn and his son versus, like, I don't know, another tag team, right? Like, against the best friends who are also there. You know what I mean? Why not use the people that you have that are there, and instead you use jobbers? The only reason I can think of is that they're paying the wrestlers, like, per match. So, you know, obviously they're going to be paying more for Trent and Chucky T than they are for, I don't know, fucking, like, Pineapple Pete or whatever, Shook D, whatever his name is. You know, so, like, they want to put that guy forward because they can pay him less and save some money now that they have no, like, ticket sales. You know what I mean? Now, here's the issue with that. You know, there's ways to do that that are better than what they're doing now. You know, like, WWE too. Like, we keep seeing people like Brendan Vink appearing on NXT, appearing on Raw. I mean, what the fuck? You know, fuck Brendan Vink. What the fuck's the point for this guy? Unless you use this opportunity to do an unprecedented story, right? You just have a guy. You have Brendan Vink, and you have him just get his ass beat by, like, Elias, like someone on the level of Elias, right? Elias beats him up for 10, 15 minutes, and the announcers keep putting over how Brendan Vink, or whoever, I'm not saying use Brendan Vink, you can use anyone you want, but pick one guy, right? And just keep putting over the fact that this guy is getting destroyed by Elias or whoever, or let's say MJF, I don't know, not MJF, but someone like that on AEW, right? Someone that's not, like, as high profile as MJF. Someone that can take a loss, right? And then you just have this person get their ass beat by Elias, let's say. And then all of a sudden, in the last 5 minutes, Brendan Vick just snaps and just, like, picks up Elias and hits, like, a big move and pins him 1, 2, 3. And the announcers then sell actual shock, right? And then it brings back that unpredictable element of wrestling, you know? And then next week, I might be interested in seeing Brendan Vink. You know, it's like, holy shit, this guy won. You know, like, maybe there's something to him. You know, just have him, like, give him a character. That's how easily you can give someone a character. A guy that sucks, but snaps, and then, like, just goes off the handle and wins. You know, you can use this to your advantage. It doesn't have to be nameless guy Brendan Vink. I mean, especially considering that it's like Brendan Vink and Shane Thorne against Cedric Alexander and Ricochet. Like, who gives a fuck? You know, like, nobody cares that Ricochet and Cedric Alexander won a match. Not one person cares about that. So why not do what I'm saying, you know? Try to run some stories with what you've got. That's all I'm saying, motherfuckers. Then, after this, we had a fucking bullshit match. It was Kip Sabian versus Goldust. Now, this match has no business being a main event match. It makes absolutely more sense, even, to have Sammy Guevara versus Darby Allin, because both of these guys are going to be bigger deals than Kip Sabian, it looks like, and Dustin Rhodes. I mean, let's be real. I was actually reading up about Goldust, and I forgot how long this guy has been a jobber. Like, I read the Wikipedia on him just because I was taking a shit and I was bored. And I'm like, let's read about Dustin Rhodes for a little bit. And it's like, basically, since, like, the late 90s, this guy has been a jobber, like, almost exclusively. Like, he's won, like, the tag titles with Cody here and there, but basically he's been a jobber. He won the tag titles with Booker T. But once again, he was a jobber. He was always a jobber. Even with Booker T was, like, the whole story was that Booker T is, like, a better wrestler and Goldust is the weak link. And he's also retarded. You know what I mean? Like, Randy Orton and Batista made him retarded when they shocked him, like, on the panel thing, you know? So, like, hearing about Dustin Rhodes and how he's a legend from Cody Rhodes, and Dustin Rhodes being like, oh, I'm a legend, I'm a veteran. Like, he's a mark too, you know? Like, I always liked him, but he's a fucking mark. I mean, like, have some self-awareness, dude. You've been doing your job for, let's say, 30 years, right? 30 years, and about 20 of those years, you have been a low-card jobber. Like I believe Goldust is going to go in the Hall of Fame primarily for the things that he did before he became a jobber. But let's be real. Other than that, he's right up there with, like, Brooklyn Brawler. Like, he's right up there as one of the best jobbers of all time. He is a jobber, man. He is, like there's no doubt about it. Like, if you look at anyone's career, if you look at, like, what's it called? Like, Hardcore Holly, Al Snow, Goldust, Godfather, these people that, D'Lo Brown, these people that were, like, let's be real, undercard jobbers for the majority of their careers. Like, they didn't really achieve much. You know, like, they're all better than Goldust. Like, Val Venus, all these guys. I mean, Venus wasn't a jobber, but, like you know, he's right up there. Like, he's better than these guys, right? But, like, he also was one of them. He was, like, an Intercontinental Champion guy. But at least Val Venus, he, like, once that was done, he left. You know, like, which is a testament to how good Goldust is, because that means that even though he's a jobber, they're keeping him around, primarily for his father's name. But to present him now as this guy who's, like, a big deal is ridiculous, you know? And, like, they're making it seem as if he has a legit shot at winning this tournament. Now, that being said, they showed a clip where Cody Rhodes is listening to a voicemail from Goldust, and Goldust is saying that if he doesn't beat Kip Sabian, he will retire. Now, I don't know if this will carry over for the remainder of the tournament, right? Because if it doesn't, that's stupid. The argument of, like, if I lose to Kip Sabian, I retire, is ridiculous. He's like, I talked to my wife. Well, what did your wife say? She said, if you lose to Kip Sabian specifically, you have to retire, you should retire, you're not cut out for this. What if next week or 2 weeks from now, you lose to Lance Archer? Are you going to have to retire then? Or is that, like, understandable, you lost to Lance Archer? Get the fuck out of here. That makes no sense. You know, like, either this is going to be the story of the tournament where Goldust makes it to the end, and it's him versus Cody, and it's like Goldust's, you know, match might be his last, and he beats Cody, or Cody retires him, which actually is interesting, right? If it doesn't go to that, which it won't, because I predict that the exact opposite is going to happen. Lance Archer is going to beat the shit out of Goldust, like, beat him bad, right? Which is going to make it so Cody wants his revenge. And then I think Lance Archer is going to beat Cody. But that's neither here nor there. They present Goldust as this, like, big deal. And then he fights Kip Sabian, Penelope Ford, and Brandi Rhodes, like, fucking interfere. Brandi Rhodes spears her, I think. And Goldust hits the Code Red, aka the Canadian Destroyer. The Code Red is not that move. The Code Red is when you do that, but it's a powerbomb. You know what I'm saying? That's not the Code Red, motherfuckers. The Code Red is the powerbomb version. He did the Canadian Destroyer, right? And they presented it. They're like Jericho's like, oh, that move that he's, like, debuted here recently. Which is true, but it's like, dude, this guy's about to retire. Why is he using new moves? You know, and he finally used it as a finisher and pinned Kip Sabian with that. Now, I like the fact that he pinned him with that and he didn't have to do his own finisher, because this is better than his own finisher. And it's honestly, like, inexcusable to no-sell these moves. These, like, high-impact moves. So there you have it, motherfuckers. That was the show for this week. A bunch of jobberish shit. They announced the pay-per-view is going to be, like, in late May, which is, like almost exactly a month from now. I'm thinking to myself, is the coronavirus thing going to be over by then? I don't think so, to be honest. So what the fuck's going to happen? You know what I'm saying? What the fuck is going to happen? We're going to have a pay-per-view with no audience? You know, you expect me to shell out 60 bones for that? Absolutely not, kids! Now, that being said, I have recorded the first of my... Well, not the first. It's also a prelude, right? A prelude to my motivational videos. I really hope that people watch that. I don't know when I'm going to release it because I haven't done the graphic for it yet. I mean, the graphic will take like 5 minutes, but I haven't done it yet. And I also have in the pipeline my long-awaited video, motherfuckers. What's it called? Wrestling is Dead. That's what it's called. So I'm going to release that one tomorrow at some point. Actually, it's going to be tomorrow at, what's tomorrow, Thursday? Tomorrow at 8 p.m., motherfuckers, at 8 p.m. So watch out for that, bitches! Pin this bitch.